Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very happy that some of you have gathered to be present for my talk on French Enlightenment with reference to Jean-Jacques Rousseau. There are some other Rousseaus also in France who are quite famous. There was one painter who was known as Douanier Rousseau. He was a customs officer. So this Rousseau is different. That's why his full name is Jean-Jacques Rousseau. He is one of the most important thinkers in the European continent. And he was a multifaceted genius and a very complex personality, very difficult to understand. His personality is very difficult to understand. And also a person who was loved and hated. That's what you have to understand. See, there are certain historical personages who are loved, and they are hated also. Some of them are hated also by one section. And the beauty about Rousseau is two diametrically opposite points of view. You know, a person following one school of thought and a person following diametrically opposite school of thought, both of them would like Rousseau. That was his personality. So we will try to understand, along with his life, I would like to explain to you his contribution to philosophy, art, literature, music. Many people do not know, was very, very, very great, much interested in music. You know, so he's contributed a lot of things to the intellectual world. So, and in 2012, they celebrated the 300th anniversary, that's three centuries of Rousseau's birth, all over the world, in all the, you know, European universities, American universities, and all, because everywhere is important, you know. See, sometimes we say, na, whether you love a person or hate him, you cannot ignore him. So he's that type of personality. You can't ignore him. So let's see, you know, try to understand what exactly he did, why, you know, so much encomium on that person. So now you will try to, please follow me. Now, first thing is, I again gave the topic French Enlightenment, and every time I have explained to you what is Enlightenment and why France was very important in the Enlightenment period. Again, short two words, the period from the end of 17th century to the whole of 18th century in Europe, you can take it as an Enlightenment period. The reason is, during the Enlightenment period, they were very much interested in using reason, rationality in all aspects of life, thanks to the scientific revolution. In one word. So they did not bother about the clergy, the religion, the Catholicism, the Protestantism, and all the religious dogmas were there, and they were also impeding the progress of science in Europe. You know the story of Galileo Galilei and many others, what fate awaited them. So a new movement, because of the scientific revolution, emerged in Europe, and that is Enlightenment. Enlightenment means examine everything in the light of reason. Don't accept anything. Authority is not sacrosanct. So that's important. So that is Enlightenment. And France played a very important role in this Enlightenment. So that's why the French Enlightenment. So first I talked about Voltaire, who was known as the prince among the philosophers of the Enlightenment. A great deal, you know, was told about Voltaire. Then after Voltaire, I talked about Diderot, who was instrumental in bringing out the first encyclopedia in Europe. So there was a very great encyclopedia movement. So Diderot was responsible. He was also a very brilliant mind. Then in my last lecture, I talked about Montesquieu, who is also equally brilliant, and he was instrumental in this idea of the separation of powers. In any democratic system, the separation of powers, the legislation, then the executive, then the judiciary. Even in India also we have adopted it. Everywhere it has been adopted. In all the parliamentary democracies, they have adopted this separation of powers for checks and balances. Because one wing of the government should not override the others. Then rule will become autocratic. If there is no check on the executive, then executive will run roughshod over everybody. So that's why we have the judiciary. So judiciary is always there to check the executive. So this contribution is because of Montesquieu. Now let's come to Rousseau. Rousseau also one of the greatest political thinkers. Just like that, like Montesquieu, a very great political thinker. Now let's go through his life. He was born in the year 1712. I have to tell you, he was born in Geneva, which was in Switzerland. So we all the time, he is coming in French. You may be asking, so what is the connection? He is actually a Swiss. Why you are calling him French? So I have to tell you, he was born in a Calvinist, Protestant Christian family. You know, Protestantism was started by Martin Luther in Germany. But then afterwards, Protestantism itself, there were different various divisions, and one of the most important Protestant group was Calvinism. The Calvinism was founded by John Calvin, who was a French man, and in France, it was the Catholic religion which was the uppermost. And there was the Protestants in France were tortured like anything. They were known as Huguenots. And once there was an edict called Edict of Nantes, which tolerated Protestants, but that was also revoked by Louis XIV. So the Protestants all escaped, France, and they went to United Kingdom, they went to Holland and all the northern countries, and they also came to Swiss. So Jean Calvin was originally a Frenchman, so he came to Geneva and he established this strong Calvinism. So later I will tell you about the Calvinism while talking about the religious aspect of Rousseau's thought. So that's why he is also French. His mother tongue is French. French origin. So many of the French people, they came to Geneva, Switzerland, and they lived there. So Rousseau's father also, a Swiss French, called Swiss French. He was a clockmaker, very ordinary. He was not born into a very noble and rich family. And the poor chap, his mother died a few days after his birth. So he describes all that in his Confessions. His autobiography is known as Confessions. It was published after his death, according to his instructions. A very great literature in French is also there in English translation. All of you can read it, very voluminous book. So his beginnings, very humble beginnings. So no mother, and his father also, what happened? He quarreled with a high official in Geneva, and he was told, you seek pardon and you leave this place, otherwise you will be put in jail. So his father had to leave Geneva, and this poor chap, Rousseau was left in the care of some relatives, some auntie and all. He didn't have a proper life, proper childhood, he didn't have. His another elder brother, he ran away. And afterwards, Rousseau never met him. It's very tragic. All this he describes in his autobiography. And he was sent to some engraver for learning some trade. And it was not a very happy experience. And at the age of 16, he was sent away from Geneva and he went to another place. Now, Rousseau was born as a Protestant, Calvinist, Protestant religion. And he went to another place. There he met a Catholic father, and that father told him, you know, I will teach you certain things, you know, that way. Probably, you know, religious things to make him as a priest, you know. So he was converted to Catholicism. Remember it. It's an important phase. He was converted to Catholicism at the age of 16, and then he was sent, you know, he works, you know, here and there in some places as a servant, you know, and he was sent to a lady. It was very crucial in the life of Rousseau, much elder to him, 12 years elder to him, Madame de Warren, her name. She was, you know, quite a high society lady, very friendly with the king. And what she was doing, of course, she separated from her husband. She was only converting the Protestant youths to Catholicism. So she was given all the funds and all that. She led a very good life, you know, well-to-do. So Rousseau was sent to her, and she was much impressed with this boy. So he worked as a servant in that house, you know, servant. He used to call her mama, mummy. You know. So she was very much instrumental in bringing him up, making him read, learn, making him, you know, practice music, all those things she was doing, and he was also doing household work and all. It's another thing, later, you know, the relationship deepened, and later you can say that there was even a romantic relationship between them. That's okay. Let's not go deep into it. All that he tells in his confessions. So, but she was very much instrumental in his intellectual development. That you have to understand. Then, so he becomes a Catholic, but heart of hearts, you know, it will be very interesting to see what exactly is religious. These are all for outward things. You know, first he is a Calvinist, then he becomes a Catholic. For eking out livelihood, he does all sorts of things. He was an engraver, and then he learns music, and he used to copy musical notations, you know, music copies. So he was doing all sorts of jobs, you know, and he had a lot of terrific experiences. But one thing about his psychological makeup is, he used to make friends and then he used to quarrel with them. So we will see, most of the cases, you know, he used to be friends with very, very top people and he breaks away. You know, that's another problem with Rousseau. So, after some time, he quits Madame Warren because she says, you go and find out. Of course, they had a lifelong relationship. He used to come back again and all that. So he goes to Paris. So the Swiss man, they are, you know, Switzerland, France and all, they are neighboring countries. So it's all not very far off. He goes to Paris. So those days, the 18th century, Paris was the intellectual capital of Europe, artistic and intellectual capital of Europe. And you had all these eminent thinkers like Voltaire, then Diderot, Montesquieu, and many, many enlightened thinkers were there. So there was a very, it's a great intellectual current, questioning everything, you know, going after, seeking knowledge. All this movement was there. Now, remember, this Rousseau's background is little poor only, you know, he's not from a very high society, you know. He had seen all, you know, misery, poverty, everything he has seen, you know. So that is the background. So, but he goes to that society. What he tries to, he invented a new musical notation. So he wanted to go and try his luck in Paris. And his life was a constant struggle, you know, to get a job here and there. He he really suffered very much. He was not, you know, unlike Voltaire. Voltaire was from a bourgeois family. His father was quite well-to-do. Rousseau's case is not like that. He really suffered. He really suffered for money. So many times he would not be having a proper place, you know, to sleep, all that. So that is his life of misery. So you have to understand his life while understanding his philosophy, because it's always, it plays an important role. Your childhood and your brought up, all these things, they have a relevance on the way you think. So there's the same thing with Rousseau also. So, and he, you can say, compared to the Parisian fellows, he was a little rustic, you know. Rustic, not, you know, very refined. Paris is known for refinement, everything, but he's not. But he goes there, but he had a remarkable intellect. You know, remarkable intellect. It's not that he was an illiterate, he was made to read, you know, not that. So he tries his luck in musical world. There also there were big shots, you know, there was one Rameau and all that, very prominent musicians. So he was not much encouraged. And he writes an opera, you know opera, European operas. So he writes an opera, a comedy, you know, called Devant You Village, means the soothsayer of village. And it became a roaring success in Paris. That we have to, you know, appreciate it. It became a roaring success in Paris, you know, what he wrote. And even the king, Louis XV at that time was there. He was also impressed and he wanted to give him a pension. So somebody said, you go and present yourself before the king. But Rousseau didn't bother. He says, I don't want all that. I mean, he didn't bother much about money. You know, he was not for, you know, he had his independence, you know. Just for money, you know, I don't, then again, I will be a slave to money and whatever they want, I have to do is. So even he could have easily accepted a pension from the king and he would have led a very beautiful life. No, he forsake it. So that was his character. That's one thing very noble about him. You know, so that became a success. Then afterwards, see, the Diderot, when I was talking to you about Diderot, I know Diderot was a great intellectual, and when he wrote a particular book, The Letter on the Blind, you know, so that had some, you know, passages against the Christian religion, if I understand it. So he was imprisoned. Diderot was put in a dungeon. In the forest, you know, there was a dungeon, Vincennes forest in Paris. So he was put in that. Now, our Rousseau befriended Diderot and he wanted to see him. So he walks along the forest, you know, to go and meet his friend Diderot. And at that time, I believe some sort of, you know, inspiration comes to him. I don't know if there is a mystic or something, but certainly it's not God, but some flash of understanding, something great, you know. He says that, you know, when he was walking in the forest. You know, Rousseau was a great lover of nature. Always, you know, the streams, the mountains, the rivers, and all, he was terribly impressed. That's why today people are researching Rousseau and ecology. Lot of research is going on, Rousseau and the ecological thought. You know, so that's a different thing. Let's not divert much. So, he is going to meet Diderot. And okay, he meets Diderot. And at that time, in some newspaper, an advertisement comes, you know, saying that the Academy of Dion, Dion is a place in France. It's not so well known as Paris. So, the Academy of Dion, they conduct an essay competition. So what is the topic of the essay competition? Whether the growth of arts and sciences have purified morals. That is the topic. So you have to write on that. Yes or no, for or against. Like a debate, you have to write and send it. So now Diderot suggests, why don't you write on this? when they did. So he took the suggestion of Diderot, and he goes and writes that essay. It is called the discours in French, huh? La première discours, the first essay. So it's very famous. You know, the first essay on arts and science. Remember it. It's a very remarkable document with two parts. You know, and what happens? He was awarded the prize. The first prize he was awarded. Instantly he became a celebrity. But the problem now is more interesting. Now, what he wrote there, if we read it, I have two or three quotations from that book. I'll tell you what is the essence of it in one or two sentences. If we read that, then we all come to the conclusion that he is the most anti-enlightened thinker, anti-enlightenment thinker. In this, he shows that streak of his personality. Why? Because at one stroke he says, all these arts and sciences, whatever you say, he gives, quotes lots of examples from history and all, they are corrupting morals. They are corrupting morals. He gives from historical thing, you know, that's his view. You know, he even quotes from Socrates, you know, there's one Platonic dialogue called Apology. In Socrates, we study about, see, when he was about to be sentenced to death, he defends himself. That's called Apology, Socratic Apology. In Socratic Apology, when Socrates is talking before the judges, you know, in one place he says, this, yes, I see these artists and all that. Of course, they are very good at their field. You know, remarkable artists. But they think that they know everything. You may be a very good artist, but you may not have all the wisdom in the world. So he gives quite a few examples. And there he condemns, Socrates condemns these artists. Saying, I mean, they think that they know everything. Because Socrates himself, he says, the difference between me and the others is, the others, they say they know something, but I say, I do not know anything. That is the difference. Socrates always used to say, I don't know anything. Anything you tell him, he would examine it, that's all. I do not know anything. So he takes from different historical things, and he says, these arts, you know, they finally encourage luxury, indolence, you know, many other things. He takes the negative. I don't think I agree with him or you have to agree with him. But he writes a very persuasive essay, and about science also. So one or two quotations I'll give you. You will see, oh, what a fool he is, why you people are talking about him. So just listen to it very carefully. In that essay, he says, astronomy was born of superstition. He said astronomy. He didn't even say astrology. Eloquence of ambition. Ambitious people, you know, eloquence. No, eloquence. You have the eloquence of, you know, Mark Antony and all that. Hatred, falsehood and flattery. Physics of an ideal curiosity. Physics was born out of an ideal curiosity. And even moral philosophy of human pride. Thus, arts and sciences owe their birth to our vices. V-I-C-E-S, vices. We should be less doubtful of their advantages if they had sprung from our virtues. Okay, that's one thing. He says, see, he's all against this class, you know, higher class. Rich people, aristocracy, people wallowing in wealth and luxury. So he says, richness of apparel may proclaim the man of fortune, and elegance the man of taste, but true health and manliness are known by different signs. It is under the homespun of the laborer and not beneath the gilt and tinsel of the courtier that we should look for strength and vigor of body. And he is also known for his term, the noble savage. So he detests civilization. He is a man of nature. Oh, live with nature. When I am a man of nature, my wants are very few, which I can, desires, my desires I can fulfill without any problem. One thinking, you know. So we cannot completely dismiss this all bunkum, but still, you know, that is his thing. So again he says, let men learn for once that nature would have preserved them from science, as a mother snatches a dangerous weapon from the hands of her child. Today we see, no, all the newfangled equipments, the defense thing, the atomic bomb, the nuclear bomb, there are many, many scientific and technological things which can destroy human beings. Even the artificial intelligence, one view is that. So we always say, no, any instrument, you know, it has two sides to it. You know, either you can use it for good or it can destroy you. In a way, it can destroy the science and technology, you know, if it goes into improper hands, it can destroy you. The biological warfare, and even in environment, so many, you know, this, what is that, you know, I forgot, Monsanto, sir, what is the, genetically modified. Genetically modified, there are two views on that, isn't it? Genetically modified crops, they can even destroy our environment. Like that, this is a germ of thought, you know, that by our, you know, foolishness, when you are not wise, you may be technically advanced and are very, very bright and intelligent, but you have the capacity to destroy the world. So that is what he says. So it is something like, so he says, God has to save us from, as if a mother is snatching a knife from a child. You know, God has to do all that. He tells it very wonderfully. Still some more quotations are there. I don't want to take more of your time on that. So this is the gist of the first essay. So he became very famous. He became very famous. Okay? Then his first essay was sometime, you know, in the year 1750. So he must have been 38. He was around 38 year old. Then afterwards, there was another competition by the same academy that was, you know, yes. So that was about, you know, they were asking about, you know, to write about the origin of the inequalities in society. That is a very famous essay. The second essay of Rousseau is on the origin of inequalities. It's human inequalities. See, in society, even today, at any time, at all times in society, there is no equality. So that was always bothering people. So they wanted people to write an essay on that. Of course, he wrote a very beautiful essay. His length was four times the previous thing, and he brought a lot of points and all. And of course, the judges were irritated with the essay because it was quite long. They did not even read it fully, so he was not awarded prize, but he didn't bother, you know. He already became very famous with his first essay, and he got it published through some other publishers. And today also, it is being carefully studied in all the political science departments. So, its points are again very interesting. The second essay, and it lays the foundation for his political thought. It's very seminal, you know, in understanding his political thought, which is the second essay on inequalities. Now, this is what is called a speculative anthropology. How everything started in the beginning. There are many people, other philosophers also. Earlier I talked to you about Hobbes. I talked to you about Locke, both British philosophers. So now let's come to Rousseau. They all talk of something known as state of nature. State of nature means in the very beginnings, before the civil society was formed, what was there among the human? You know what? How it all started? Now we are all citizens enjoying the fruits of civilization. we are a society, everything, government, all those things are there. So he thought about it. Other philosophers also had thought about it. What did Hobbes say? Hobbes say, in the primitive state, in the state of, you know, the state of nature, everyone was at war with the other person, each against the other. Man was, you know, brutish, stupid. He used all very phrases like anything, you know, Hobbes. So each against the other, each killing the other or attacking. So that was the state. And what happened? Then each will be afraid of the other. So they go to a very strong person and they say, we surrender all our rights to you. You please look after all of us. You see that I am not attacked by the others and others are not attacked by me. So that is the beginning of what Hobbes called as the absolute state, its absolutism. He wrote a very remarkable book called Leviathan, which about which I talked to you earlier in one of the talks. So we are not going to talk. His view of nature is man is inherently bad. You know, you always, of course, we try to have self-preservation. I have to protect myself. But he positively said you are a bad person. You know, man inherently is not good. So that is Hobbes' nature of man. Hobbes' man is selfish, brutal. Then there was Locke. Locke was more interested in the rights and the property. Man's rights and property. So he also had a political theory. He also said, yes, in Hobbes also it is a contract for an absolute ruler. In Locke also he said, no, no, our rights have to be protected. So we entrusted to a person or a government or a king. So his duty is, he has to ensure that our rights, especially our property, is protected. Locke was very much interested in protecting the property. Now comes Rousseau. So Rousseau also, what his idea of human nature is very important, which is spelled out in the second essay. So for him, the primitive man, before the emergence of civil society, he says he was interested only in fulfilling his wants. No, his food and other things. That's all very basic needs of any human being. He was interested only in that. So he said, in that state, man was good. So this is a departure. He was good. He was not an evil person. He had to go, he has to do some hunting or something, he has to go to the forest, take, eat something, plant or something, or hunt some animal, eat. So that was the thing. So he was not interested in any other thing. So at that time, two things. One is his self-protection. Okay, he calls it amour de soi. Amour means in French love, love of self. Love of self means I have to protect myself from attack and all that. So I won't go and attack anybody. I have to protect myself. And I have to live. So my needs were very basic. So I am not a bad man. So the human nature, according to Rousseau, is quite good in the beginning. Means before the emergence of the civil society. And what happened? He says, afterwards, you know, lots of people gather and you have your family, you know, other things, you get your children and all. Then the moment, so there is a gradual evolution of society, and the moment somebody said, this is my land, you know, he enclosed something, a piece of land, and put up a hut and said, this is my land. He says, that means this is my property. The moment somebody started that and others believed it, then he says, hell was let loose. Which is, that was the beginning of all problem in society, corruption, all corruption. He tells very beautifully, in the beginning, the earth belonged to none. it belongs to none. The produce of the earth belongs to all. So when that is the case, how one person can say, limit some area and say, this is my property. And so he says, that's the beginning of all mischief. And he says, this Locke, Hobbes and all, so their society, those social contracts, they are all fraudulent contracts, because Locke wants to protect the property which was acquired fraudulently. So that is his thesis. He says, this is the problem, the property. The moment you say, this is mine, he says, all the, and there are many people to appreciate this point of view, including Marx. Remember, Marx was quite inspired by Rousseau. Marx was inspired by Rousseau in this aspect. He says, how can you, I mean, that's the problem, you know, the moment. And some people say, why this inequality? Somebody is having lots and lots of land, and another person, he has to work in his farm. You know, he has to work day and night, and he will get some subsistence living, some paltry thing. So he analyzes all these things. And further he says, the primitive man, apart from this amour de soi, self-love, he had in his psychology what is known as pitié. In French, pitié means compassion. Pity. Compassion. He says, inherently, what is this compassion? When you feel for the suffering of the other person, that is compassion. He says, in the primitive stage, the compassion was very much part of the human quality. You know, one human being, when another person suffers, he also suffers that empathy, you know, whatever it is. Today they may call mirror neuron and all in neurology. That is there, you also feel. He says, that is very much a part of the human thing. But the moment you started acquiring property, not only property, other things. Again, he comes to the arts, sciences and all. So, a large farm. So he particularly takes up agriculture and metallurgy. Many, many things have to be done once the society becomes complex. Then he says, certain persons are identified, you know, as more capable than the other. So he says, this is the inequality. He says, there are two types of inequality. One inequality is from the birth, natural, because everybody's capacity is not the same. Your strength is not the same as my strength. You inherit certain things, I inherit certain things. Your intellectual capacity may be different from mine. He says all these things are okay, but this is natural. But there is an inequality which is man-made. So he is elaborating, you know, expatiating completely on these man-made inequalities. So he deals, you know, very beautifully, you know, the origin of these inequalities. So that is the second essay. It's a very remarkable essay. It set people thinking. So his thesis is, the inequality is man-made. He says it need not be there inherently in nature. That's only certain other things. But all the other, so he says, with your better capacity, he says, comes pride. Okay? The pride comes. And with your ownership of many, many things, huge land, huge property, then do you think yourself equal to the other person who is coming and working in your field? No, it cannot be. So you feel you are superior. This is an inequality is being made, because you people, the human being, he is making the inequality. And the pride, he calls it amour propre. In French, it's called amour propre. Apart from amour de soi, what is this pride? Pride is, I am superior. I belong to the higher class. And this is, he is nobody. So he says, this mentality is being developed because of this social development. You know, where, you know, the inequality started with property. So this is the thesis in the second discourse. So second discourse, I will just one or two quotations, I will read it. They are interesting for their rhetoric. You know, you have to read Rousseau even in English. You know, for the language, you know, it's very moving. You know, his language, it will stir your heart. Every sentence, he was capable of making such phrases that will melt the hearts of people. You know, that is his, the lyrical quality of his prose. You know, and those who know French, they will enjoy it much better. But even in English, they look very nice. I will read only one quotation. There are many. The first man who, having fenced in a piece of land, said, "This is mine," and found people naive enough to believe him, that man was the true founder of civil society. From how many crimes, wars, and murders, from how many horrors and misfortunes, might not anyone have saved mankind by pulling up to this imposter, saying, "Beware of listening to this imposter. You are undone if you once forget that the fruits of the earth belong to us all, and the earth itself to nobody." He says nobody was there to pull up the imposter. So somebody said, "This is all mine." We accepted. So that is the beginning of inequality. So this is a very remarkable thesis. So now his political, you know, gradually his political thought develops. This is not the end of his political thought. So the third important work, it was in 1762. So by the time he was 50 years old. He wrote, see, the first two are very beautiful, you know, from the language point of view. The third is a very serious book, you know, very, very serious. It looks like a legal document. So it is the very famous Social Contract, Du Contrat Social, in French, the Social Contract. So that is the most important work of Rousseau. And Rousseau's political thought. It has got five parts. Remember, this book gave him a lot of trouble. I have to say, it gave him a lot of trouble. And more or less during the same period, he wrote two more books, about which also I will talk to you. One is Emile, or On Education. It is a semi-novel philosophic book, both novel and philosophy, both fiction and philosophy. That is Emile or Education. It's a book on education. Then he wrote an epistolary novel in the form of letters. It's called Julie or New L-O-Z. Third novel. Look, let's come to this Social Contract, because it's the most important work of Rousseau. It's beginning there. First sentence itself is very charming and arresting sentence. Man is born free, but everywhere he is in chains. That's the beginning. You know, very catchy. And then he elaborates. Now, what is this freedom? And what is this chains and slavery? And how to get out of it? So, that is the subject matter of this Social Contract. So we already talked about Hobbes and Locke. Now he is actually elaborate. Remember, all his thoughts, there is a unity in his first essay, second essay. There is his essay on political economy also. Then there is this Social Contract. There is no contradiction between one one book and another book, there is a strand of thought, you know, running through all these books. So that we have to understand. Now, in social contract, the subject is, it's a new concept he is introducing. So here also, it is, after talking about inequality, so all the civil societies, he says, they are only perpetuating the inequality. What all your government is doing, no, they are perpetuating that inequality, saying that I am protecting the man who is having property. Because they don't understand how he got the property. Nobody is going and doing some research on how originally he or his forefathers, you know, how they got all those lands and all those wealth. Nobody, no. But presently, the duty of the government is, yes, we have to protect property and his property. So he says, these are all fraudulent things happening in the civil society. So he has some sort of ideal system, prescription, you know, for what is his aim. The thing is, when he said man is born free, the important thing is our freedom, or you may also say liberty, it's very important, individual freedom. In any society, the individual freedom, yes, you should have some freedom, yes. Freedom is important. But how freedom is compatible with, okay, your government or your ruler or a king or somebody who is bringing out order, your sovereign, you can say, whatever it is. See, in any civil society, both things, individuals have to live with, they have their own freedom, liberty, but then they have to live with others. Of course, Hobbes gave a solution, Locke, he gave a solution, but according to Rousseau, they are all fraudulent. So what is his prescription? What does he prescribe? So here only, let us try to understand him. He says, there is a way of reconciling individual freedom, which is called, he calls it will, individual will. He introduced another concept known as the general will. So this is what we have to understand. These two terms are important. Individual will is my will, your will, every will of every member of the society. So that is the individual will. Okay. And what he coined as the general will. So the term general will is the most important term in law, in Rousseau's political theory. Let's try to understand it. Of course, many scholars have explained it. It's a little difficult conceptually, you know, because I don't find a visible manifestation of general will anywhere. You know? So what is this so-called general will? Now he says, each of us, we have our desires. I want to do this, I want to do that. Each of us. My desire may conflict your desire. But we all have to live together. We all have to give together. So he says there is a particular will, means a way of doing things, that's all. You can call it law, legislation, anything. There is a particular way of doing things which will benefit, which will be good for all of us. For all of us it will be good. That is the general way. Okay. Interchangeably you can call it also as the sovereignty. It's not a person. It's something abstract. No? The general way is that which is going to benefit everybody. Now what should we do? We all should enter into a contract. So that's why the social contract. Society coming together in a contract means we are all agree. For a contract, for doing something or not doing something. What is it, that contract? That contract is for following all of us, the general will, irrespective of our individual. So you have to understand that individually you may say, oh, this may be nice for us or for our group and all that. But this is the law. This is the general will. The sovereign has decided this. So all of you have to understand that better we follow the general will than our own inclinations. There may be a few, one or two, who may not obey. But then, Rousseau says, that is where a lot of criticism. He should be forced to follow the general will. The word uses, he is forced to be free. He gives a new meaning for freedom. After all, he says, the freedom is not following your private will or individual will. When you have decided to follow the general will, he says, that is your freedom. Your freedom is that. You may not agree with him. So that is what he says. So that wisdom you should have, that come what may, I am going to follow the general will. The general will is not against anybody. It is for the good of all, so I will follow it. So when somebody X or Y doesn't follow, he will be forced to be free. Since he used that word, there's a lot of criticism of Rousseau by the other side. You know, there are two sets of thinkers, one pro-Rousseau and another anti-Rousseau. Anti-Rousseau, they say it is all nonsense. So you are going to force us to follow, you know, to be free. What is this conduct? It is something like an oxymoron. Contrary, isn't it? You know, it's an oxymoron. In English language, they will say, how can you be? You are forced to be free. Free means I have, so freedom means I have the choice. How can somebody force me to be free in some particular way? So many, many thinkers have said that this is responsible for the totalitarian tendency in the world. That means what they say is, one upstart leader, he will say, my will is the general will. A Hitler or a Stalin or a Mussolini, he would say, what I say is the law. That is the general will. All have to follow. You will be forced to follow. So this can be misused. So there is a lot of criticism for this thing. But there are scholars who say you should not take that type of meaning. So what Rousseau is saying, Encyclopedia Britannica article says, say for example, somebody, you know, one recalcitrant member of the society is doing something very much opposite to the law. Definitely he will be hauled up. So that hauling up, you know, some suitable punishment or he will be put in jail or whatever it is, he says that is what he means by forcing somebody to be free. So you should not take a very perverse meaning of this statement. So that is one thing. So, and it's a very, you know, a very serious book. It deals with many, many things, you know, the different types of government, you know, all that, you know, there's no time for that, that's not needed. What you have to understand is the concept of the general will. Then, what gave him trouble in this book, as well as in the next book, which is Emily on Education, so that gave him a lot of trouble. What trouble? Because he spoke about religion. You know, he is a Christian, okay, by birth. First he was a Calvinist, then he became a Catholic. And afterwards he wanted to go to Geneva again, but they would not allow him unless he become a Calvinist. So again he becomes a Calvinist. So this is all for other purposes. But his real religion is something different. Which he brings out in his both the books he brings out, and that gave him a lot of trouble both in France as well as in Switzerland, Geneva. So he was going from escaping from one place to another, and all. He was all the time living in hiding. No, poor chap. Although he became famous because of these books. In fact, his novel, Julie or Eloise, You know, it was the most romantic, no? He is also the father of romanticism, remember. In Western philosophic movement, he was the father of romanticism. He has been, you know, inspiration for many romantic poets and all, Wordsworth, Byron, Shelley, all these people have been inspired, you know, by Rousseau, you have to understand. Now, so he had to move from, so that particular novel was hailed like anything, was the best seller in Europe in those days. And many, especially he had a lot of women following, you know, because it was very sentimental, you know, sort of love story and all that. You know, so they were all moved by his book, that particular novel. You know, huge, you know, it's a very voluminous novel. So, now in all these things, what happens? His religious thought is neither, he's not, Christianity is only a facade. What he says is, I believe there is God. Okay? There is God. Okay? He says, I feel that there is God. And he says, he also believes that good actions means good life. Bad actions means he will be punished. He believes in afterlife. Okay? Very simple. Not many dogmas. And he finds God in nature. So he doesn't have much, respect for all the revealed religions, many, many dogmas, scriptures and all that. That is his religion. So this is brought out in the book, Emil, as well as in Social Contract. In Emil there is a chapter, The Faith of a Savoyard Vicar. Vicar is a religious thing. So there is a particular vicar, you know, he was expelled, you know, because he did some mischief, some misconduct. But later, he says he finds his own religion. So, the religion, he says, in all your religion, the most important thing is in your inner consciousness. Conscience. Now, we say it, no? My conscience. So, he gives importance to the inner conscience. You know, the supreme power is there. Nature, you can find God in nature and you have to do good things. Bad things, you get punishment. So, not many dogmas. So, he says, he brings out these thoughts in his work and how will they accept? First of all, they are all angry with Social Contract because France was ruled by a king. So, you know, king, there is in political science a theory called divine rights theory. The king is there because of the divine right. God wants it there. So that is their superiority, you know. So when you say no king and all, we will form a contract, they were upset. They burnt his books. They put it in the list of banned books. So he cannot go to France. He cannot go to Switzerland. But see, now I have to tell you about this Calvinism, tenets of Calvin. 10 more minutes I will take because it's a very vast subject. Calvinism, I will tell you the tenets, because it will be very funny. And also, remember Rousseau's point is, man is very good. When man is born in his natural state, he is very good. It is only the society which corrupts him. It is only the society which corrupts man. And when a child is born, he says it is good. So that is his theory, which he brings out very beautifully in Emil and other things. But now, see the tenets of Calvinism. I won't read all the tenets, only one which is important for our talk. Total depravity. What is this total depravity? Every human is completely sinful from the moment of birth. So, this is the tenet of Calvinism. Even the Catholic thing, the moment the Adam fallen, he fell down from his status, isn't it? Adam, the Bible you know, all know, na? The eating of the forbidden apple, then that is the fall of man, and the entire human generation inherits the sins of Adam and Eve. So when these are the tenets of Christianity and Calvinism, if a man speaks of inner conscience and man is good by nature, he has no place in that system. So his books were burnt and everywhere arrest warrant was waiting for him. Poor chap, he is fleeing, he is a fugitive from law, and finally, you know, he goes to England and he befriends Hume, the famous philosopher Hume, the skeptic. You know, he became friendly, Hume was very much attached to him and all. But unfortunately, this Rousseau, he was suffering from a paranoia, in the sense that he thought everybody is plotting against him, is going to kill him and all that. So, they got a pension to him from the King of England. Many people helped him, but suddenly some doubt, some persecution complex, people are after him and all that. So, that's one thing. So he again returns, you know, comes to France, and somebody gives him place. Again, two or three things are very interesting. He